We are very happy today to have Elli Pomoni, and she's going to talk about type B anomalies on the Higgs branch. Please, Elli.
Thank you, Shara, and thanks all to all the organizers for having me here today. I will present work that has appeared in these two papers. I hope you can see well my pointer. And it's work with Vasilis Niarchos, Kostis Papagiorgakis, and Alessandro Pini. And let's start easy, so that we are all at the same page. So let's talk about conformal anomalies. So conformal field theories in even dimensions, when you study the gravitational effective action, you see that you cannot simultaneously preserve diffeomorphisms and wild transformations. And this is the anomaly that is manifest precisely in the class between the conservation of the stress energy tensor and the tracelessness of the stress energy tension. And usually what we do is we keep diffeomorphisms, we keep the conservation of the stress energy tensor, and we sacrifice the vial. And this is the famous vial anomaly. And we have the A coefficient in front of the Euler density and the C coefficient in front of this tensor combination. So this is, should be something that everybody knows and loves in this audience. And now we take the next step. So this is an old work back from 93. So conformal anomalies can be classified in type A and type B. Type A are really nice. They, first of all, they do not introduce a scale when they appear. They can be expressed in terms of topological invariance. And because of all these properties, basically they are very, very similar to the anomalies that we know and love, the chiral anomalies that we have studied much more in life. And well, this is the state of the art paper on this topic. They should match across different dimensions. And the argument was given here. And when you think about type A anomalies, well, the A anomaly that I had in the previous slide is an example to keep in mind. Now, what are the type B anomalies? Well, the definition is that they introduce a scale. So they are conformal anomalies that I come with a logarithm. And as far as we know, they can depend non-trivially on couplings that our theory has. And because of this, they can be very complicated functions. And there is no argument, we have no reason that these anomalies should actually match in different phases. And again, to my knowledge, this is the state of the art. When you think of type B anomalies, you can think, for example, of the C anomaly that I had in the previous slide. But for this talk, I am not going to concentrate on the C. I will concentrate on another example. So I will look at in the CFT phase, I will look at two-point functions of local operators with integer scaling dimensions. And we will see that they are also related to an anomaly that I will introduce. So what is the main point of this talk? The main point of this talk is to ask the question, should this type B anomalies match, yes or no? So first of all, we will study concrete examples and we will see examples of matching and examples of not matching. And given that, then I will try to organize what we learn from the examples and try to say why and when we expect the anomalies to match and also when we expect that they should not match. And to do this job, I will use n equal to 2 superconformal field theories for which we know many things by now, and I really have a very good handle, so I can really calculate. And I will always compare what happens in the CFT phase with what happens on the Higgs branch, where by going to the Higgs branch, I break conformal symmetry spontaneously. let's go a tiny little bit more in the detail. So in the CFT phase, as I said, I will compute two-point functions of operators with integer conformal dimensions, n is an integer. And I will get a logarithm because they are type B anomalies. And the coefficient in front of the logarithm is the anomaly I care about. And as we will see, because I will review the argument from this paper, this is also encoded in a three-point function with a stress energy tensor in front of this specific kinematic combination. Okay, P2 and P3 are the momenta of the two local operators, that not the stress energy tensor. So let's move on. Something got stuck. Sorry for this. Okay. So the motivation for this work, basically, in some sense, came just by reading the paper of Swimmer and Tyson. And we really wanted to understand when this anomaly should match, should they match, should they not match. And of course, we know that for the A anomalies, this was something very important. So having this paper out, Komagorsky and Swimmer were then able to derive the A theorem using the matching. So maybe by understanding type B anomalies, this will be a very nice way to, you know, extra information for RG and blah, blah, blah. And another thing, so back then in the day when we started studying this paper, we cared about actually deconstructing the 2,0 theory on a torus via this four-dimensional n equal to 2 quiver theory. And yeah, back then we were studying the index or partition functions and we were matching them and we were very happy to check the deconstruction in this way. And then we were, you know, simply thinking, can we match other nice observables? And of course, chiral correlators was one of the first things that came into our mind. So here is the plan of the talk. First, I will introduce the anomaly by reviewing the argument in this paper and how it appears in the two-point function and in the three-point function in the CFT phase. Then I will do something else. I will derive a Ward identity for this three-point function. So we have the stress energy tensor and the two chiral operators, and a covariant derivative of them is zero. And I will show that this is both correct in the CFT phase and in the Higgs phase. So here we have, especially for the Higgs phase, a new type of Ward identity. Having this covariantly constant object, well, this is great because then it's enough that I can just check the matching of the anomalies at one point on the conformal manifold. And of course, this will be the weak coupling. And if they match there, this means that they should always match. Of course, if they don't match, they will never match. And because weak coupling is a point of the conformal manifold, I will do a simple Feynman diagram calculation. So again, having matching is a great thing. And what is even more great is because these operators allows for exact computations coming from localization, I will be able to get an exact result on the Higgs branch, which is very cool. We don't have ways to do these things. And when there is mismatching, I will try to argue that we have now a novel way to have restrictions on the conformal manifold using precisely this mismatching. And finally, okay, we will see, because I don't know how much time, it might be that I will go slower than being able to do this. I will try to say some things about the deconstruction, but I definitely have my slides there. So even if I go over, people can ask about deconstruction. So let's begin by reviewing the paper by Swimmer and Tyson, at least a little bit from it, what is useful for us. So again, a conformal anomaly is the clash between diffeomorphisms and viral. So what do? We write down the Ward identity for diffeomorphisms. We write down the Ward identity for viral. And then we do the following. First of all, we take the three-point function and we decompose it in the possible tensor structures that can appear. Here, remember that Q is the momentum of the stress energy tensor, and K1, K2 is the momentum of the two chiral operators. And I take the difference between them, and I take Q to go to zero, and then the two momenta to be equal. The moment you do this, and with a little bit of massaging of your equation, you discover that this coefficient here is zero from the diffeomorphisms. But then if you try to track it also from the vial, you get that it's not zero, and it's proportional to the two-point function. And this is precisely the class. And what is more, for the CFT phase, the anomaly coefficient is proportional to the two-point function. Okay? Now I want to break conformal invariance. And as I said, I will do it going to the Higgs branch. But let's go slowly, because there is an important object, the dilaton, that will play a role for this work. So the dilaton is the massless Gonstone boson that is precisely associated with the spontaneous symmetry breaking of the conformal symmetry. So when you give a VEV to some scalar, you will create masses in the Lagrangian. But then you can look and you can find the dilaton, which is a massless real scalar, and you can study its effective action. And what is very nice about the dilaton is, of course, here is the usual kinetic term. It couples linearly to the trace of the stress energy tensor. So its equation of motion precisely captures how the T mu mu is broken, is not zero. This is very important. Precisely we have this coupling. When we go to the broken phase, the analytic structure of the correlators will be different from the one that we are used to in the CFT. There will be a pole precisely because of this propagator. Okay, so this is something we have to be careful and we have to keep in mind. Okay, something that most probably everybody knows in this audience, but just to set my notation and just, I don't know, maybe there's someone that is not super, super symmetric here. So Qs are the scalars in the hypermultiplet for me, phis the scalars in the vector multiplets. And going to the Higgs branch means that I don't give a VEV to the phis and I give a VEV to the Qs. And I will always give it the VEV in this nice diagonal way, so the simplest possible way to give a VEV. Doing that, I break conformal symmetry spontaneously, as I already said before, but I preserve my n equal to 2 supersymmetry. I break the SU2R symmetry because the phis, they have SU2R symmetry indices, but I preserve the U1 because these guys, the phis, they have U1. So Qs have SU2 and I break SU2, phis have U1 and I preserve it. Okay, this is what we need to know. Now let's say what happens in the Higgs phase. So in the Higgs phase, as I said, because of the dilaton propagator, I have to be careful and I cannot just go and put Q to zero as I did before. And the reason why I cannot do it is precisely because of this dilaton coupling to T mu nu, I will pick up a pole. So then I will not only have, when I look at the diffeo word identity, I will not only have the A contribution, I also have to keep this contribution. And when I look at the vial word identity, I mean, it will be a little bit messy, but you can clearly see there is still a class between the vial and the diffeo. And precisely because of this mess, the anomaly coefficient now in the Higgs phase is not directly related to the two-point function, but that's great, no problem. I will define my G Higgs as taking the three-point function, killing the appropriate derivatives that were multiplying it, and taking the limit in the end. So this is a very good, careful way to pick up your anomaly on the Higgs branch. So my operators O, I will choose them to be the Coulomb branch operators CBOs. I will have, Coulomb-branch operators. I will use this acronym many times. These are gauge invariant local operators whose VEVs parameterize the Coulomb vacuum. And here as a, I am not going to go to the Coulomb branch, but I will consider these operators, okay? I will consider two and three point functions of those operators. These operators are very special. They live in very special, if you open your Dolan-Osborne, very special representations. They are totally chiral or totally anti-chiral. So they killed with all the Q bars or all the Qs if you pick the bar of that. And also they are the conformal primaries or super conformal primaries better. So they are killed by all the S's. And this I am going to use in a derivation of the word identity that I will do in a moment. So yes, so this is one of the things that, you know, I need to know by heart in order to do what I want to do in the next slides. And what is also very important, so first of all, if there is a Lagrangian description, trace phi to the L is the way they look, or multi-trace multiplications of that. They enjoy a chiral ring structure, and they have non-trivial OPs. And also, if you take the smallest possible guy, the trace phi squared, and you act with all your Qs, you pick up marginal deformations. This is a fact of representation theory alone. Fantastic. Now I take my Coulomb branch operators, and I want to say a few more things about the conformal manifold. So the first thing that I already said is that the marginal deformations descend from them, from the trace phi squared guys. The conformal manifold is the moduli space of all these exactly marginal couplings. And I can, on the top of that, define a non-trivial connection on this conformal manifold.
Eli, you are only considering the n equal to preserving conformal manifold.
Yes, n equal to 2 preserving, yes. For n equal to 1, there is not much technology. I mean, apart from your n equal to 1 paper with Zohar, I don't think there is much technology one can play with. Great. So here is how we will define the connection. And this is this goes back to an old paper of Zbibak and friends. And Kyriakos pushed forward this type of work in his 2009 paper on the TT star equations. But for this talk, it's enough to know that this connection is, I mean, it is, you know, it's not just the derivative with respect to the marginal coupling, there is a connection. And the way it works is that you have to insert a marginal operator in your correlation function and integrate. And something that is very important is that this is regularized in a very specific way, but I'm not gonna talk further about it, unless you have questions or maybe in the end. Okay? And what is nice about these guys is that we can obtain them from a localization prescription. And yeah, using this technology, you can go very far. So let's continue. Now we want to derive the word identity. And let's derive the word identity first in the CFT phase where life is very easy. So here I have written the superconformal word identity. J is the superconformal current. And on the right-hand side, you have to act with all your Qs and your S's. And of course, also the superconformal current is written as the killing spinor times the operator G that lives in the C hat 000 multiplets of Dolan-Osborne. And when I do, so I form my three-point function that I want to compute and I act with a connection. I have to insert, as I said before in here, the marginal operator. And I think of it, because it is, as I said before, as Q to the fourth on the primary. And now what do I do? It's very simple. I just apply this word identity, the integrated form of it, on this correlation function with three Qs. So basically what I do is that I steal one Q and I start hitting the other guys with that. It is a small calculation, but it's easy to show that then you simply get zero when you start moving this Q around. And I will just say one thing. So here is the Dolan-Osborne stress energy tensor multiplet. You need to know also this multiplet in order to do this calculation. So you need to know where T is, you need to know where G is, and which, how many Qs and precisely how they look like. Okay? But you do this and you derive the, this word identity. And this should not be very surprising. Maybe there is another trick I can say very quickly, that by choosing the killing spin, or you can, in fact, can hide one operator. But anyway, this is if you really want to do the calculation. So now we go to the Higgs phase. And in the Higgs phase, you know, life is harder and we have to be very careful. And well, the superconformal current is just not conserved. But what do we do now? We need to see what can happen, what can come from the left-hand side. And first of all, it's good to go to the momentum space. And write what is the possible thing that can happen? How this supercurrent can, you know, what contributions can we get? And we talked before about the dilaton, but now we have n equal to 2 supersymmetry. So in the multiplet of the dilaton, there is also the dilatino, which the same way the dilaton couples to the trace of the stress energy tensor, the dilatino couples to G, the operator part of the supercurrent. So then, by just knowing that, you know that this is the contribution that you are going to get. And in fact, in the limit of the momenta of the stress energy tensor going to zero, this is precisely what you need to be careful about. The dilatino is going to have a propagator that will create a pole. However, so first we write it out. We for a moment feel sad that we failed, then we will not have a word identity. But we look at this correlation function slightly more carefully. This is singlet under the U1R symmetry, but the dilatino is not, precisely because it's in the multiplet of the dilaton. So precisely because of this, and precisely because the U1R is preserved, as I said before, we get again this nice word identity also on the Higgs branch. I think this is a cool result by itself. If there are no questions,
can you explain what is physically means on the when you go on the Higgs in the Higgs phase? What is this connection?
The connection, fantastic question. The connection, as I said, is related with the way you bring the marginal operator down and then you have to regularize. But regularizing is something that you do in the UV. So, and in fact, the way you regularize, you actually consider little balls around the operators so that the operators cannot collide. Mm-hmm. So the scale that you introduce by going to the Higgs branch, it's much lower than the UV regularization that you are doing. So the idea is that this nabla here is basically the same. I think there is a raised hand.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, I've had a quick simple question. Is there a simple example? What's the simplest QFT that has non-trivial connection?
The simplest?
Yeah. Like Ising model, such phenomena that you're describing of this type B anomalies in n equals 2 theories.
I don't know, for me the simplest is n equal to 4 super young Mills or some two-dimensional supersymmetric theories. But yeah, I'm sure you can define, as long as you have a conformal manifold, you can try to define for your favorite CFT.
So in SU2, n equals 2 super young Mills, there is already a non-trivial connection. What does it look like as a function of U, maybe?
Wait, what is U?
Well, whatever coordinate we use on a conformal manifold.
Oh, I use the coupling constant, G young Mills, or lambda, or whatever. Yeah, it is not easy. So this is actually a hard question that you are asking, because the connection is actually complicated. It's not so easy to say what it is. So first, yeah, I mean, it's not so easy, actually. So I cannot give in 1 second answer. Mm-hmm. For n equal to 4 super young meals, there is a frame that you can go in which the connection is flat, and you can make it zero. But this is only for a specific frame. I mean, the whole thing with the connection is that you have local operators that have the same quantum numbers. So you can do non-trivial transformations with respect of your conformal manifold, and this can mix in complicated ways. This is what this connection captures. I think this is the most physical thing to say.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Can I make a comment, quick comment about this?
Yes.
Since we're discussing conformal field theories, a very useful way to think about this connection is to do radial quantization, and then it's just the Berry connection. So, for example, in n equals 2 superconformal QCD, this connection is non-trivial. It's basically a connection like Levitz-Civita type. It's metric compatible with a metric that the two-point functions of Coulomb-branch operators that you compute from localization. So there you compute from the matrix integral complicated functions of the Young Mills. Or tau and tau bar, and you can compute the connection from this two-point function. So they will look complicated. On n equals 4 square Young Mills, it's just, you know, it's basically the curvature of the connection is flat. So.
Thanks, Vasily. So I hope it's good now.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thanks a lot.
Fantastic.
That was helpful.
So now we are good, because now we derived these two word identities. Now I wrote them in terms only of the anomaly coefficient, which is the thing I care about. And now we can talk about matching and not matching. And let's phrase the criterion nicely. So first of all, you can just combine them in one differential equation, first order differential equation in this way. And just by looking at this, it should be very clear that if and only if we can find one point on the conformal manifold, here I call it lambda star, on which they match, precisely because of this first order differential equation, the anomalies will match at every point. Of course, if they don't match, they will never match. And because, you know, it's any point on the conformal manifold, I will, of course, choose the point in which I can calculate, which is the weak coupling. So let's now calculate. First, the first example we considered is...
Elli, can I have to ask
you
before you... So, what is this bundle of the conformal manifold? That disconnection with the muscle.
So it's very strange because I cannot see who is asking the question. Can you see the name?
Ibu.
Oh, Ibu, sorry. So the chiral operators, the Coulomb-branch operators, define vector bundles over the manifold, basically. And that's it. That's the bundle.
Okay. Thank you.
And we know that bundle is topologically trivial, right? It has holonomies, that's all.
Yes.
It has holonomies.
Mm-hmm.
They will come, they are coming in a couple of slides, I mean, maybe a little bit more than a couple of slides. Good. So let's do a three-level computation, because that's something we for sure can do. And I want to compute the three-point function in the Higgs branch. So I take my Lagrangian, I go to the Higgs branch with everything, all the new vertices and all the masses that are created. There, first of all, as I said already before, by looking at the effective action of the dilaton, we know that the stress energy tensor couples to the dilaton. So this is the beginning of my Feynman diagram. And then the dilaton couples to all the massive scalars. So here are, with this green, sort of green color in my loop, all the massive scalars, which in the end are weak contracted with the operator, I want to compute the three-point function. Okay? So first of all, okay, practically this is a three-level diagram because I just use these two vertices and I just weak contract. But in terms of calculational difficulty, actually this is an L-loop integral. And in fact, it was one of the crazy technical things that we had to do in the second paper to really nail down the calculation with all the factors and everything. And the people, I mean, this is sort of, there are people that they care for QCD reasons with the banana integrals. So you find these banana integrals in these calculations. But I will not tell you anything technical. I will spare you all the hardship. So first we look at super QCD with an F is equal to 2K. I am sorry if this is annoying, but because of the deconstruction, we were calling the color group as UK. And by the way, the same thing you can do for other color groups. And we compute this MAD integral. And we can show with all the factors and everything that I will spare you how to do it, that it's identically equal to the CFT result. And this you can do for any operator, trace phi to the L. And of course, you can also do double trace, you can do whatever you want. And they match. And then, so using the word identity that we derived before, for super QCD, they should always match at any point in the conformal manifold. Now, this is our second concrete example. And this is a circular quiver that is, in fact, this is where the deconstruction comes. Like, this is the quiver that you use when you want to deconstruct the 6D2,0 theory. And you have SUN color factors everywhere with the same rank. Here, what happens is precisely the same type of calculation. But when you just do it, you find that on the Higgs branch, you get this result, and it doesn't match with the CFT, precisely by this stupid 1 over n to the L. Okay, the first moment is disappointing, clearly, to find a not matching. The second thought, of course, we did, is that, this is okay, because when we go to n, which is to infinity, which is the limit we care for deconstruction, this goes away and it is matching, so it's not so bad. But then we need to understand what is going on and why this guy is coming here. So the reason why this contribution is there is the following. From all of these scalars that you have in every vector multiplet, you can form what is so-called the untwisted contribution. So by doing phi 1 plus phi 2, just direct sum of all, of course, with 1 over square root of n. This is, you can think of as a center of mass mode or untwisted mode. And for us, this is the alpha is equal to 0 case. And this guy, if you look carefully in your Lagrangian, this guy is massless. And precisely because it's massless, it doesn't couple to the dilaton. That's why this thing is subtracted there. So this is how I understand this non-matching. And further, and for that you need to be careful, when you want in fact to compute the anomaly for this untwisted mode on the Higgs branch, you should not only consider this diagram, because this is the diagram that gives you how it couples to all the massive guys. You should also consider something else that, for better or worse, we decided to call it GIR. What does this mean? It means that we should also calculate the contribution of this untwisted guy, and this untwisted guy couples directly to the stress energy tension. And you can compute again this with just simply weak contracting, and you basically get that this is equal to precisely this. So for the untwisted mode, there is matching. Okay? But for any other alpha, for any other twisted mode, there is no matching, and this is how it is. Let's try, now that we looked at these concrete examples, to put everything. Yes.
The n equal one case is the n equals four supernumeraries, right?
N equal to one case. Yeah, I guess you can say that. Okay. Yes.
And then it everything matches.
In every n equal to 4 super young mills, everything matches because of the following reason. If you remember your Dolan Osborne, the n equal to 4 half BPS multiplet, or the intrilligator Cordova, I'm sorry, you are in front of me, I have to say this. So you look at the representation theory, right? So the n equal to 4 stress energy tensor multiplet breaks into the n equal to 2 stress energy multiplet, plus the two chiral, the ones that they have the, and precisely because of this, they have too much, because they are in the same multiplet. Okay, is this obvious or it's too fast? So it's just this, it's just Dolan-Osborne. So let's put everything in, because I like we want to understand what is going on. So let's try to phrase it in, let's call it conjectures, because of course for Lagrangian theories you can calculate and you can be happy, but for non-Lagrangians you cannot really calculate. So let's, yeah, let's phrase it like that. So first conjecture, if there is a trivial IR chiral ring, and when I say this word, I start with the Coulomb-branch chiral ring in the UV, I do my Higgsing, some guys get massive or not. So if all the guys get massive, in the extreme IR, no one is going to survive. So the chiral ring is going to be empty, it's going to be trivial. Sorry, there is a question. So can you just ask the question?
Yes, is G with superscript H metric on the Higgs branch?
Yeah, I mean, you can, it's the anomaly coefficient, that's the correct thing to say. So you compute this three-point function.
Yeah.
You look at this pi to the n, p2 to the n, this precise kinematic thing. The coefficient in front of it is that.
I see. And you're saying that...
And it's also what I also proved, and I will come back to this in a moment. I have also proved that it's covariantly constant with the nabla, which is the same, you know, torsion-free connection that I also had in my CFT. So that's what we know up to now.
I see. Okay, all right, thank you.
So at this stage, I'm just thinking about anomaly matching. And I am happy because for the super QCD example, I found matching. And for this circular quiver, I found that for the untwisted guy, there is matching. And for the twisted modes, there is not matching. And I am trying to put, to organize what I learned. So for the super QCD, I mean, there was only one phi, it got a mass. In the IR, it's not there. So the chiral ring is empty, it's trivial. And the conjecture is that type B anomalies match. If the IR chiral ring is not trivial, and the example of that is precisely the elliptic quiver we just looked at, where there was this center of mass, this untwisted mode, which is massless. So in this case, there is something in the extreme IR. There is one operator that survives. In such case, the anomalies which are associated with the Coulomb-branch operators that survive in the IR, they match. And all the other ones that are orthogonal, so the other twisted modes, they are not expected too much. And also what is, I mean, not so obvious unless you, I would show you more of like how we did the precise calculation. If you can show that the generators of the chiral ring, for them there is anomaly matching, then for the whole chiral ring there is matching. But anyway, this is a secondary conjecture. It's just maybe good for the calculations. Are we happy with this? Because this is one of the important things, basically. If we are happy, one of the cool things that happens when you have matching is that you can use your CFT phase calculation where we have localization, you can compute this anomaly, and then you can import this result to the Higgs branch. And now you have an exact result in the Higgs branch. And I don't want to say too much because also maybe it would take too much time. Maybe I just say that, I mean, first of all, in the papers by Kyriakos and Vasilis and Baggio, they started this business, and then In this paper, they nailed the thing. So you can always obtain. So here I'm giving an example for delta is equal to 2 Coulomb-branch operators, which is also the most clean thing. So you just take derivatives with respect to the marginal couplings of the Pashtun partition function, and you get your two-point functions. And yeah, maybe here I reviewed, here is how the result for n equal to 4 super Young Mills look like. And this is something that maybe is important to stress. So for n equal to 4, the Pashtun result is very easy. It's a Gaussian matrix model, and we can compute no problem. We can solve the matrix model. For n equal to 2 theories, the matrix model, nobody, at least to my knowledge, but I don't think it's otherwise, nobody knows how to solve. So we can perturbatively go ahead and solve with Mathematica, but it's an ugly business, and it's also not nice in terms of understanding what is going on. Here I have the first correction. So this is the 3-level, g to the fourth, and then this is the first order correction after that. It's two loops afterwards. And at 3-level, you have only diagonal terms in this type of metric that you are defining. But after the first correction, you start getting off-diagonal entries also. Okay, this is a very cute property that I really like. Because so omega, you can think of it as the twist operator that takes you from the one twisted state to the other. And you can also write down how the untwisted answer looks like. And it looks like n equal to 4 super Young Mills, which is great. So by the way, this is only perturbative, no instantons. This is in agreement with the inheritance argument back from the early SCFT days. And of course, and we calculated a little bit that there is a whole complicated series of non-perturbative instanton corrections, and you can go a little bit calculating. Of course, at some point you get tired. So this is the status of what we can calculate. Now let's talk about mismatching. So when mismatching happens, I already said that this is great because we can get some restrictions on the conformal manifold. Let's try to understand. So first of all, what do we know? What is the status of what we know about the conformal manifold? Well, basically, this is basically the paper you need to read if you want to know everything that is out there. We know that the conformal manifold, again, for n equal to 2, is scalar Hodge. And if you don't know what is Hodge, it's written here. And when the conformal manifold has n, dimension n, then we know because of that, that the holonomy should be a subgroup of UN. That's all we know. Now let's recall what we just showed. We showed that when there is a mismatch, there is a covariantly constant, basically this is the Zamolodchikov metric, and the second symmetric rank 2 tensor, another metric that is also covariantly constant with the same connection. And they are not equal. And when I write that they are not equal, it's not like they are not equal by some overall C number, they are as matrices not equal. So, you know, if you think what this implies, this implies that there should be further restrictions to the holonomy group just because of this. And this is, I think, first of all, just by looking at this, this is very nice because this indicates that there should be some indirect constraints on the conformal manifold by looking at the Higgs branch, which is, yeah, this is a very nice thing, I would say. Now let's a little bit look at this a little bit more. So first of all, using the localization data that we already have, and I said that they are complicated, but we have them, we can calculate them. The first thing you can do is that you can calculate the holonomy, and you find that it's a U1 to the N. So I am looking at the circular quiver. It's a U1 to the N. And using the RAM decomposition because of this result, you can say that at least locally, the Kähler manifold is n irreducible one-dimensional Kähler manifolds. So this is what I know from localization. Now, with a mismatch, without even pushing too much, we know that there is this relation between the Higgs metric, or whatever you want to call it, tensor, and the CFT one. And just by looking at this, what is the isotropy group? U1 because of this, un minus 1 because of this. And this is very nice. So at this level, we don't have something new to say, but this is at least a check. The isotropy group that we got contains the holonomy that we were able to get from localization. Okay? And how you could push this further. So we just did a three-level calculation. We did nothing. So you could either try to go to higher loops and see how these equations here change in higher loops. Of course, this is hard. This would not be the first thing that I would like to do in my life. But there is something maybe smarter thing to do. You can try to compute the mismatch with different Higgsing patterns. And I have to say, I haven't done it, but it looks to me very clear that what is gonna happen is that I mean, 90%, I would say, I wouldn't bet all my money, but I would bet a little bit of money. With different Higgsing patterns, you should basically be able to get n covariantly constant metrics under the same connection. And well, if you could get n, then like very quickly, this will become U1 to the n, and you can start thinking. So this is, I think, the way to go in order to really learn with our mismatching game. How are we with time? Okay, maybe I will say very quickly a few things about the deconstruction. And I mean, it will be quick and not nice, but then people can ask more questions after the talk. So this slide more or less wanted to summarize what I know, and I guess what we know as a community about the 2.0 theory. And mostly we don't know much. Here I have written that maybe the bootstrap is a good way to go. And of course there is the topological string approach, but yeah. So what did we do to use the deconstruction to say something? So the first thing you need to do is you need to use your representation theory. And the first thing you need to do is you embed the 4D n equal to 2 superconformal algebra into the 6D, 2.0. And by doing that, you can identify which BPS condition goes to which. And for what we care about, the 4D delta is equal to R Coulomb-branch operators, they get mapped to operators in this multiplet. This is the, this is this half BPS multiple of the 2.0, and they are specific Rth descendants of this multiplet. So this is very good, because now, again it got stuck, sorry for this. I don't know why this is happening. Okay. For the lack of time, and because I want to conclude nicely and slowly, I will not now read you all of this, what is the deconstruction. You can ask me in the end if you want to know what is the deconstruction. But with just what I said about multiplets, and also remember that in the deconstruction limit, I stressed that in the previous slide with the elliptic quiver calculation, in the n to infinity limit, we have anomaly matching. So basically we can obtain this. This is a part of the three-point function in six dimensions of the stress energy tensor now in six dimensions. And here you have this half BPS operators. The deconstruction works that you take the 6D theory and you put it on a T2. So you have two types of Kaluza Klein modes. Here I call them A and zero is because this is a zero mode. So the one tower is related with the Zn symmetry, which in the limit where n goes to zero becomes a U1. So it's related with the different twisted states. And the other circle, the other Kaluza Klein tower, is related with S duality. And this is something, in fact, we don't really quite understand how to, because it would be nice to really just say this is the three-point function and we are done. But for that, we need to do S duality. So let me conclude nicely, and then we can have nice questions. So what did I do in this talk? Okay, first of all, I reviewed one of the important things we know from this paper. And what we know is that we have the anomaly coefficient when we look at this three-point function, the stress energy tensor with the Coulomb-branch operators, and we look at this specific kinematic coefficient. So this Gij is the anomaly. In the CFT phase, this anomaly is precisely equal with a coefficient in the two-point function in front of the logarithm. What's very cool is that this coefficient, because of localization, we can compute exactly. The other thing that I did is that I derived this word identity for you. I showed you both how to do it in the CFT phase and on the Higgs branch. And then I argued that the moment we have these word identities, if we can show that there is matching at one point, and I took the weak coupling as my point, then there should be coupling at any point on the conformal manifold. Of course, if there's no matching at three level, there will never be matching. Then the findings of this, I studied concrete cases, the super QCD and the elliptic quiver. And from these cases, we had this, when there should be matching. Well, when in the IR, the n equal to two chiral ring is lifted, there should be matching. And when in the IR, there are some operators, they survive there. So this means that there are some massless phis. For the ones that they survive in the IR, there should be matching, but for all the other ones that they became massive, we don't expect matching. So now what is cool is that when there is anomaly matching, we bam, get an exact result on the Higgs branch by doing our calculation in the CFT phase. When there is a mismatch, I argued that this opens a new opportunity to learn about the conformal manifold by thinking about restrictions on the holonomy group, precisely because we have these two different metrics. And as an outlook, there are maybe many things that I could say one would like to do. But maybe the coolest thing that one should think about is how now we can use what we learn to learn about RG flows. I have nothing smart to say at this stage, but I'm sure this is like a super important thing to try out. A more down-to-earth thing is that try to do Higgsing with different Higgsing patterns and see if you can get more covariantly constant metrics. So instead of saying I have two, I have many, what does this do to the holonomy? Another cute little thing that we in fact already are pursuing because it's relatively easy, we can ask in fact the opposite question. What about if we go to the Coulomb branch and we consider Higgs branch operators? Can we say like the same stuff? Can we say something cool like that? Can we derive the word identity? Yeah. And then for the deconstruction, of course, this is very important because this anomaly calculation predicts a piece in the three-point function of the 2,0 theory. And yes, the only other ways we have to study the 6D is the chiral algebras. And of course, maybe for large n, you could do some ADCFT. So if we could make this calculation perfect, we could start doing some nice things. And I guess, yes, that's it. Thank you very much.
So thank you, Elli, for the very nice talk. So please, I think we have some time for questions. So there is already a question. Not at all, please.
Hi, Elli. I have a question. So from what you said, this means that for theory of class S associated with the Riemann surface with the higher genus, there's always a mismatch, right?
So what I said is the following. If you have a higher genus, you go and you look for, first of all, the, let's call it, you want to call it center of mass or untwisted operator. This guy, he will enjoy matching. All the other ones, they will not match.
And for class S theory, can you compute a mismatch exactly? Suppose that
this example that I gave you here with the elliptic, the circular quiver is like it's one of the basic examples that you study when you study class S, right?
Yes, this I'm is asking, suppose that you don't have Lagrangian. Do you know?
Yes, so at this stage, I haven't done any calculation about that, and I don't know. Mm-hmm. But you see, I don't know. So one of the favorite things that you should have is the TN theories, right? So the TN, you can get them by, you know, pushing yourself to the edge of the conformal manifold, right? Of course, you have to be careful because some things will decouple, but they are continuously connected with this type of theories, or better, I don't know, T3, right? That's my answer. So I haven't done any calculation, but for example, for TN, I would not say that it's insane to try to set up something.
Okay, thank you.
Maybe related to Nopadol's question, so you can look on SU2 generalized quivers where everything is Lagrangian.
Yeah.
And say you can look on genus 2 theory, where you have two different duality frames, which are both Lagrangian. And then you can compute in both of these frames and see whether you have a mismatch, if it's the same mismatch, because the theories are different. Did you try to do that or?
No, I didn't try, but this is a cool proposal. Yes, I agree. Yeah.
Thank you.
I mean, in what Slomer proposed now, the only pain is to, you know, to get your factors right. Everything else we have. Of course, the factors will be a pain, but yeah.
That's the main pain in physics.
Yeah. But what I'm trying to say is that we have done all the hard work. The integral, all the madness, it's there.
So I don't see other questions, so can thank again Elli for the very nice talk. And
for having me.
So maybe we can stop the recording and just